When we speak of philosophy, we must always begin from somewhere. We begin from the pre-existing conditions of our lives. That is the platform from which we launch our thought. So today, I want you to keep that in mind here at this afternoon graduate seminar in philosophy of mind at Johns Hopkins. The specific circumstances of your life which got you to this clean, well-lit room. It will be very important in what's to come in my lecture. But first, I have to communicate something to you from what I can only call the imperative. He has brought five fish, sold three, eaten one, and given away one. There's nothing paradoxical about that. But the more you think about it, the more an uncertainty creeps in, because after all, this is happening in a paradox. It's not happening in a normal situation. You may start to go into a greater analysis to try to unpack this problem logically, so to speak. And then be forced to think in terms of the problems of contemporary physics, multiple worlds particularly, and wonder if indeed you may be, as if by accident, in a universe where this paradox, the paradox of the fisherman's baldness, is a valid paradox. How do you check for that? It's very difficult. So you begin to check not just the inferences associated with the fisherman, no, no, but all of the inferences of your life, every one. In fact, it's difficult to know where you should stop. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're saying to yourself, there's something wrong with this reasoning. I felt that way myself, but I was always drawn back as if to a very cold, cold flame. To this idea of the paradox. And I began to realize that to resolve it, one might need a medium very different from language. A medium capable of other things, a more subtle current that could carry the meanings free ourselves from this conundrum. A sort of melancholy sets in. For the paradox is nothing, if not a special case of nothing. And there is loss involved. Well, I may have lost you, but let me try again. I'm going to roll the tape, and we'll see what happens. Maybe with my PowerPoint presentation, we'll be able to get a little more deeply into this before the afternoon's over. Thank you.
My name is Victoria Winters. Winter, most wintry winters. My journey is beginning, and I am at the start of it. A journey that I hope will open the doors of life to me and link my past with my future. A journey that will erase and meld these doors to the future's past. A journey that will bring me to a strange and dark place. A place with less light than others and odder than some. To the edge of the sea, high atop the distill, at the top of this peak, a house called Collinsport. Collinsport. A world I've never known, with people whom I've never met. People who have never met nor known me. People who tonight are only shadows in my mind, shifting slightly like windless leech beetles humming with motion, but who will soon fill the days and nights of my tomorrows.
Is Jason McGuire. My name is Jason McGuire. I've been in Collinsport for 3.5 years now, and I've seen many things during my stay in Collinsport. The things that I have seen have been sights to my eyes. I arrived in Collinsport, it seems like only 3.5 years ago, to do business with an old friend of mine, Elizabeth Collins Stark. Lizzie is the matriarch of the Collins estate. An old friend, a wealthy one, a sturdy lady, an old hunk. That secret, so shall it remain until. And nothing and nobody can stand in my way of me reaching my way. But oh, that woman, Victoria Winters, is the only thing that stands in my way of inheriting the entire estate of this place. Victoria Winters came to Collinsport to take care of David, a child of young pedigree. Victoria is a woman who came here to Collinsport to take care of David, his father, his Roger Collins. Roger, you think someone is trying to kill him? He? Can it be? He lives in the fear, the constant fear that someone is trying to kill him, Roger Collins. Could it be? Will he do this? A young, wily companion of mine who lives in a town and does general chores for the neighborhood until he was bitten by some unknown, mysterious biter? Maybe he did it. Or maybe it was Berndt, Devlin, about whom I don't think I know who he is. At any rate, something in this town is just not right, and